In 2020, Catherine O'Hara won her first acting Emmy for her hilarious performance as the Schitt's Creek matriarch, Moira Rose, via the New York Times. However, while many fans first fell in love with the star for her work on Schitt's Creek, O'Hara is hardly new to the biz. In fact, even if you've only come to be familiar with O'Hara after binging Schitt's Creek, she's probably made you laugh out loud in at least one of her many iconic roles. The legendary comedic actress has made a name for herself by portraying perfectly pitched, wacky characters in films like Best in Show, Waiting for Guffman, and For Your Consideration. And if you were a kid in the 90s, you'll likely also remember her as Kevin's concerned mother in the Home Alone series. Despite her impressive career, O'Hara actually came from very humble beginnings. She grew up in a small Canadian suburb as part of a large, Catholic family, via the Canadian Encyclopedia. Brandon Leake first auditioned for America's Got Talent in 2017, but at that time, he wasn't accepted as a contestant, possibly because there had never been a spoken word artist on the show. But 3 years later, not only was the timing right, in fact, the world, in the middle of a pandemic and civil unrest, needed to hear what he so eloquently had to say. "I prayed for this," the Stockton, Calif native told Parade.com after his win. "These moments are moments I prayed for years. This is a prayer I sent up over 10 years ago and it is now being answered." From day one, the 27-year-old educator and motivational speaker moved the audience by baring his soul. His first appearance was a poem about the death of his baby sister. And while she's a total comedic legend today, O'Hara didn't necessarily plan on being such a star. Here's a look at the stunning transformation of Catherine O'Hara. Catherine O'Hara grew up in a big, playful household. Catherine O'Hara's comedic roots date all the way back to her childhood. The actress was born in 1954 in Toronto, Ontario, and grew up in Etobicoke, a Toronto suburb. Her family was certainly a large one. She was the second youngest of seven children, via the Canadian Encyclopedia. By all accounts, the O'Hara family was a jovial one. From there, he moved to Black Lives Matter with a personal twist. He talked about his estrangement from his father, but for the finale, he ended on a positive note, professing his love for his six-month-old daughter Aaliyah, and he says that that was the first time he had a qualm about it. "To be honest with you, I was scared at no other point besides this last one," he said. "I was a psychology major." As the star explained to The New Yorker, "Everybody in my family's funny." O'Hara continued, saying, "Being funny was highly encouraged in our family, I think." Growing up in this happy, funny family gave O'Hara the foundation she needed for a career in collaborative comedy. "I understand how humanity works." She told Time that the family dynamic she experienced while growing up instilled within her a love for working with other comedians. "Sharing stories of pain with other people is vulnerable, but at the same time, my pain is an easy experience to share with others because we've all experienced that." He continued, "But to share joy and love with other people is so much more vulnerable, because we try to keep those things protected and safe, so that nobody tries to pick at that. I've never, for a second, been drawn to the idea of doing a one-woman show," she explained. For O'Hara, funny runs in the family. Both of Catherine O'Hara's parents taught her about comedy. Catherine O'Hara learned a lot from her large family about working with other comedians. However, she also credits her personal comedy style to both of her parents. Speaking to The New Yorker about the influence her mother and father had on her sense of humor, O'Hara explained that her dad preferred jokes, while her mother's go-to was imitating people. "So, knowing that this last poem was nothing but love and joy, I was, man, could I handle a critique from the world about my love of my daughter? I said, no matter. This is her gift. It doesn't matter what anybody else says." As O'Hara revealed, she picked up her mother's talent for impersonations. "I impersonated people for my dad, and that would really make my dad laugh," she recalled. O'Hara also learned a lot from her dad's comedic style, too. "My father was a beautiful, shy man," she told Vanity Fair, recalling that he worked a regular, boring desk job, but would still somehow manage to return home with amazing jokes. "I like to think I'm a combination of my parents," O'Hara said. According to what we know about them from her stories, it's safe to say the star is definitely a healthy mix of her mom and dad. Catherine O'Hara was not lucky with her love life in high school. For Catherine O'Hara, comedy has always seemingly come easy. "I'm going to make sure she gets this gift."
Leake's talent wasn't just a gift to his daughter, but a gift to all of us. The subject matter he covers delves into those things that make us human, and as such, his poems are not only relatable but timeless. But funnily enough, he shared that when he writes, he really doesn't think about others. This may sound selfish, but I just try to write from an authentic place of where I'm at, what I'm dealing with, the pain that I'm dealing with at the time, he said. However, the star hasn't always been so lucky in the love department. Usually, I write after the healing has come and able to have the hindsight of, damn, Brandon, that's why you were there. The fact that it is timeless just happens to be a matter of circumstance, I believe. I believe that the skill of being able to write well comes with an ability to withstand the test of time. D. Speaking to Marie Claire in a January 2020 interview, O'Hara divulged some interesting tidbits about her younger self's love life. Apparently, the Schitt's Creek star used to have a real thing for the conventionally attractive, tall, dark, and handsome guys. She joked that if she could give her younger self advice, she'd say, that sexy, dark, brooding guy isn't a higher-level thinker. O'Hara continued, joking, turns out, he actually has nothing on his mind. She went on to explain that she certainly had some poorly chosen crushes throughout her youth, something to which just about every person can relate. However, according to O'Hara, she never had a steady boyfriend while attending high school. I hope to be one of the poets who can withstand the test of time. Read on for more of our conversation, in which Leake talked about how he is feeling, his goals, what his Las Vegas act will look like and what it means now to be an inspiration to the spoken word community. You're a man of words, describe how you're feeling? I will give it to you in one, I am humbled. I am humbled beyond imagination, because it could have been any spoken word artist. I stand on the backs of giants in this community, who have done this work for years, Jessica Kerr Moore, Mo Brown, Harlem Renaissance people like Maya Angelou, Langston Hughes, and more recent artists. I stand on these people's backs and I get the opportunity now to be the face of spoken word. What is the goal now? Touring around the world. I guess I was too busy hanging out and goofing off with my lovely girlfriends, she explained. I want to get out, I want to see more places. I want to share this art with the world. On top of that, I have a deep passion to do acting on television and movies, writing for television and movies, even directing television and movies, so between those two and continuing to be an awesome dad and a wonderful husband, I got a full plate. What will your Las Vegas show look like? Before coronavirus ever happened, I had an hour-long show that I used to do in Sacramento, but it is strenuous. Considering she's made an entire career out of goofing around, we'd say O'Hara's high school self made the right call. Catherine O'Hara met Gilda Radner through her brother, which led to her job at Second City. Catherine O'Hara's chance meeting with another comedy legend changed the course of her life forever, and it's all thanks to her brother. According to Vanity Fair, O'Hara's life changed forever when she met Gilda Radner as a teenager. It is a beautiful thing once you get your stamina up to do it. Yesterday, people got a brief glimpse into what it looks like for me to do spoken word with music. I do live musical accompaniment. I do a mixture of spoken word with animation, like dancing going along with the music and the words. Of course, Radner eventually went on to become a comedy legend, known for her work on Saturday Night Live via The Independent. I do live art being painted in front of you. And while Radner eventually married fellow comedian Gene Wilder, she was dating O'Hara's brother at the time, and had just been accepted into the cast of the stage musical Godspell. I interact with the audience, stuff like that. There is a lot that goes into a live show with me. Did the fact that this happened in the time of COVID have any effect? I would have been ecstatic no matter what happened. If it had been season 14, 15, 16, 17, you can't take anything away from a season in which you win. For myself, the only thing I wish I could have changed would have been to have had my family here the entire time to celebrate, to be able to do all of this, but to have them here now as soon as this is over, I am rushing into their arms. O'Hara had auditioned for the play, as well, and while she didn't get a part, she was inspired by seeing the cast both backstage and on stage. O'Hara's relationship with Radner opened her eyes to the possibility of a life in show business. I am looking at the clock to make sure we can watch the fireworks go off together.
Speaking of your wife, what was her reaction? She was crying, she was super happy for me. For O'Hara, Radner's lifestyle was cool and chic and exotic, the Schitt's Creek star explained to Vanity Fair. She's, when are you coming back? I'm, as soon as I'm done. The pair had sleepovers, went shopping together, and eventually, when Radner joined Second City, a Canadian improv troupe, O'Hara became her understudy. I promise I'm coming back to you. The rest, as they say, is comedy history. Being on SCTV and Second City taught Catherine O'Hara about improv and creating oddball characters. Catherine O'Hara sharpened her comedic skills through improvisational comedy, much like many other comedy legends we know and love today. After landing a job with Second City as Gilda Radner's understudy in 1976, O'Hara's life became all about her new comedic improv troupe. We're going to hug it out. The improv team included other legends to be, such as Dan Aykroyd, John Candy, Andrea Martin, and Eugene Levy. I'm going to kiss the baby. We're going to do the whole thing. She's over the moon for it. At one point, it seemed as if you were more excited about winning the show in Las Vegas than the money. Winning the money is going to be awesome, but the biggest critique that people have had of me this entire time is, this isn't a Las Vegas act. This is a coffee shop thing. O'Hara recalled the exciting, creative time as being similar to being in a band. I look forward dearly to being able to show all what I have in store for this Las Vegas act. On the finale, we saw you watching videos of people responding to you, talking about how you inspire them. What did that mean to you? That is one of the rare moments in my creation when I've been able to see the genuine impact that my time on the show is having on the spoken word community in general. You are creating your own material like a band. One of the biggest things that hit me was seeing that little girl. It's so musical, she explained to Time. She's the daughter of my friend Christoph. He runs an organization called Poet Life on the East Coast. She went on to say that the show gave her the freedom to explore her unique method of character creation using improv. Using collaboration and research, O'Hara is able to create characters that are simultaneously larger than life and incredibly realistic. The troupe became lifelong collaborators and friends after their 6 seasons on SCTV. As she explained to Vanity Fair, being a part of the successful comedy troupe opened a lot of doors for her and really got her career off to a great start. Catherine O'Hara and Eugene Levy dated for a little while, but became lifelong friends apparently. Catherine O'Hara and Eugene Levy have more of a history than some Schitt's Creek fans probably realize. Of all of the friends O'Hara met through SCTV, the one who has perhaps been the most influential is Eugene Levy. To see her say, I'm a poet, too, and I'm going to go on America's Got Talent myself, that's one of the biggest things for me that this opportunity was for, to be able to open a door for other spoken word artists to be able to do what we do and to have a platform here and to say, I can go out and the world will be able to recognize who I am and what I do. There were plenty of other talented acts in the finale. Get to know the rest of the AGT 2020 finalists. The pair have collaborated on projects together for over 40 years, with 4 Christopher Guest films, multiple voice projects, and, of course, Schitt's Creek under their belts. And you'd be forgiven for thinking they were a real-life couple based on their intimate relationship and long work history. Even though both actors now have long-term partners and families of their own, it turns out, they did actually date briefly when they first met. As O'Hara explained on Watch What Happens Live with Andy Cohen, there's nothing sexier than laughing together and having someone who makes you laugh, so everybody at Second City Theater tried to date everybody. The star added that it was pretty lucky in the end, as their friendship and brilliant working relationship may have been ruined by their romantic relationship. Catherine O'Hara almost missed out on her Beetlejuice role even though Catherine O'Hara was finding plenty of success as a cast member on SCTV. Her career really started to take off when she was cast in a few big-budget Hollywood films. As longtime fans may recall, O'Hara's first few film roles were secondary characters. She played Gail in Martin Scorsese's After Hours in 1985, as well as Betty in the Meryl Streep film Heartburn in 1986 via IMDb. In fact, it wasn't until she'd left Second City that she landed her first really big role as the evil stepmother in Tim Burton's 1988 classic, Beetlejuice. As O'Hara told the New York Times, she had been asked to audition for the film by producer David Geffen. Apparently, she didn't know who Burton or Geffen were at the time, and when she finally agreed to fly from Toronto to LA for the Beetlejuice audition, she got lost. When she finally arrived 2 hours after her set audition time, Burton had left. Nevertheless, he clearly loved her previous work, as she got the part a few weeks later. Catherine O'Hara moved from Canada to Hollywood in the 80s to marry Beau Welch eventually. Catherine O'Hara made the big move from Toronto, Canada to Los Angeles, USA. However, she didn't move to Hollywood in order to pursue her acting career. As it turns out, the actress made the move for love. While filming Beetlejuice, O'Hara fell in love with Beau Welch, the film's production designer. She recalled that Welch was very attractive, and revealed that she was elated when he, finally, asked her out. The couple began dating while they were filming on location, O'Hara explained to The New Yorker. And when the movie finished shooting, she moved to LA to be with him. In 1992, the Lovebirds made things official by tying the knot via Yahoo. Needless to say, it's pretty lucky that O'Hara fell in love with someone in the film industry, as her move to LA ended up helping her win even more exciting acting roles throughout the years. We're sure she's happy to have found her soulmate. Catherine O'Hara wasn't always the superstar actor she is now. Catherine O'Hara steals pretty much every scene she's in, whether you're watching her in Beetlejuice, Home Alone, or Schitt's Creek. So, it's hard to imagine that she ever struggled to find success in the movie industry. However, as O'Hara revealed to Vanity Fair, she hasn't always found show business easy, especially when it comes to auditions. Speaking with the publication, O'Hara recalled meeting the head of a Canadian network early on in her career. According to the Star, when he asked her if she could do any characters, she ended up giving him some pretty poor descriptions instead of actually showing off her skills. Later, O'Hara was up for a big role in a Robert De Niro movie. Apparently, she was asked to read a scene that took place in bed, so she slid down in her chair and stretched her legs out. As O'Hara explained to The New Yorker, this particular audition is one of her most embarrassing memories. When you're on the job, it's so collaborative. It's about everyone, O'Hara said, explaining why she's never been a fan of the audition room. The Star continued, saying, "When you're auditioning, it's only you." Catherine O'Hara was shocked by the success of the Home Alone series in 1990. Catherine O'Hara took on what would become one of her most iconic roles as Kate McAllister in the Home Alone film series, in which she delivered the scream heard around the world. As O'Hara told Vanity Fair, she was lucky enough to be offered the role in Home Alone without having to audition, which was good for the Star, considering she hates auditioning. And while she was happy to land the part, O'Hara revealed that she and other cast members were downright shocked by just how successful the film proved to be. O'Hara gave an interview to ABC News in 1992, explaining that no one predicted the movie would take off in the way that it did. According to the Star, when the cast reunited to film the sequel, they all said, "Do you believe what happened?" Speaking with the Movie Waffler years later, O'Hara said, "I had no idea Home Alone would have such a long life in the hearts and minds of moviegoers." However, regardless of whether or not O'Hara knew it at the time, Home Alone certainly proved to be a career-defining moment. Catherine O'Hara had two sons who went on to work in set design. Catherine O'Hara and her husband Beau Welch eventually started a family, welcoming their first son, Matthew, in 1994. 3 years later, in 1997, the couple welcomed their second son, Luke, via Yahoo. Little is known about the two Welch sons, as the family likes to keep their lives pretty private. However, O'Hara did reveal to Time that she envied her character in Schitt's Creek for getting to spend so much time with her grown-up children. "I'm always wondering where my kids are," O'Hara joked. According to Vanity Fair, both of O'Hara's sons decided to pursue careers in the movie industry, just like their parents. One of O'Hara's sons is a set dresser, while the other works in set construction. And as it turns out, both actually worked with O'Hara on Schitt's Creek. Considering her co-star and on-screen husband Eugene Levy also had his two kids, Dan and Sarah, on set, filming Schitt's Creek sounds like a fun and funny family affair. Schitt's Creek and its cast became incredibly important to Catherine O'Hara. Perhaps Catherine O'Hara's biggest career-defining role came in the form of Schitt's Creek's Moira Rose. As fans know, the role earned the Star her first acting Emmy Award, and she soon became a cult-like hero amongst viewers. However, O'Hara almost didn't take the role. As O'Hara explained in a behind-the-scenes interview for Schitt's Creek, she hesitated to accept when her old pal Eugene Levy initially asked her to join the cast. Needless to say, she's now embarrassed about her hesitation. "It's lame to talk about not wanting to do it in the beginning," O'Hara said. She continued, "How stupid would I have been not to have done it?" As she told Advocate, Schitt's Creek quickly became massively important to her. According to the Star, she even cried while filming the final season, and again when she was watching the final episodes of the show. "One thing's for sure, it's clear that being involved in Schitt's Creek was transformative for both O'Hara's career and personal life." Catherine O'Hara can't imagine another career high like Schitt's Creek. Catherine O'Hara will always have a special place in her heart for Schitt's Creek. When Schitt's Creek came to an end in 2020, O'Hara expressed that the show may have been a career high for her, or, the career high. In 2019, after the show's end had been announced, she told the Los Angeles Times, "It's going to be hard to let go." She continued, saying, "I've been able to do this show where I get to play this ridiculous but lovely character." The star went on to add that most roles for older women are about death, divorce, and disease. In an interview with Vanity Fair, O'Hara confessed, "I don't see trying to top this. How greedy can one person be? While we would love nothing more than to see O'Hara get another amazing role, we have to admit, it's pretty hard to imagine a character that could possibly compete with Moira Rose." In 2020, Catherine O'Hara received two Canadian awards to honor her long career. Though Catherine O'Hara was understandably sad to see Schitt's Creek come to an end in 2020, the year was definitely momentous and exciting for her, as well. In addition to her Emmy win, O'Hara was also honored by Canada, her native country, for her impressive career achievements. In fact, she received not one, but two Canadian awards in one year. The first was the 2020 ACTRA National Award of Excellence, for which O'Hara was selected to win by ACTRA, a group of Canadian actors, for her outstanding contribution to Canada's entertainment industry. In a statement about the award, O'Hara said, "I am forever boasting about all things Canadian. Thank you so much, fellow ACTRA members." O'Hara continued, joking, "If I wasn't a good Canadian, I'd brag about this lovely honor, too." The second Canadian award O'Hara scored was the 2020 Lifetime Artistic Achievement Governor General's Performing Arts Award, an incredibly high honor. It's clear that O'Hara's home country is incredibly proud to have raised O'Hara, and the star is equally proud to be a Canadian.